Andrew Henderson, NomadCapitalist.com. This is the Nomad Capitalist Report. We're talking about entrepreneurship and freedom, two things that go hand in hand. When you add in the element of overseas business, it adds a whole new dimension of freedom and taking it back for yourself. Jake DeSillis is the host of the Voluntary Life podcast, voluntarylife.com. He joins me now from Mexico to talk about how to become a global entrepreneur, take back your freedom, and all the things that he's done to do just that. Hey, Jake, welcome to the show.
Hi, Andrew. Thanks so much for having me.
You're in Mexico. We've heard a lot about what's going on down there, but give us your bird's eye view from actually being on the ground. But pass the propaganda. Share your experience.
Well, I mean, Mexico, we're here really as a just as a great place to be if you want to enjoy a good standard of living at a cheap price, really. Both myself and my partner, we work online. And so we've spent this winter abroad. We're from the UK, but we've been in Argentina and Chile, briefly visited Uruguay. And Mexico is just a fantastic location to, you know, if you like sunnier places in the winter, and if you like cheap food and great accommodation, it gives you the opportunity to, if you work online, you know, have a great standard of living at a lower cost and still be able to do your work.
The U.S. propaganda machine with their travel warnings and everything else would tell you that the moment you step foot into Mexico, your head's going to be blown off and it's going to be all downhill from there. Your head is still intact, though, it would seem.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's the interesting thing. I think Mexico is a really big place. It's the size of Western Europe. And there are some places where you clearly don't want to go, into the mountains, and the Sierra Madre is where the drug war is really happening. And especially in the north and towards the border with the US. But there are other places that are completely peaceful, really laid back. And you know, we've just had a fantastic time in the places that we've stayed, and it's fairly easy to see, you know, where the sort of problematic places are and where the completely safe places are, and to just, you know, make your choices accordingly. If you're not involved in the drug war, and if you don't, you know, mix with any of those people or anything like that, you don't see any of that. I mean, we've seen, I guess, the only sort of evidence of that kind of thing that we've seen is that there are sort of very heavily armed police that you see on the highways sometimes, and you see police checkpoints in some places. But for example, we're staying in a beautiful little town on the beach called Sayulita. We don't see anything like that. This is a, you know, it's a really gorgeous sort of beach town, and very quiet, very peaceful. So it just depends where you are.
I want to talk to you more about all the places in Latin America, because so many people, we talked to Adam Kokesh, and he says, listen, this is where people in the United States are going. Some people like Asia. Certainly there are places like the Philippines where you can find more of an American standard of living at a cheap cost. Also Latin America. So I want to talk more about that. But let's get into entrepreneurship. You've talked a lot about this on your podcast. You have talked about three reasons for someone to start a business, and that maybe some entrepreneurs are doing things for the wrong reasons. Talk about that.
Yeah, I mean, I think sort of for anyone who's getting into entrepreneurship, good reasons for doing entrepreneurship are any reasons that keep you going, because it is really hard work and it can be really challenging. And so, you know, there are the difference between the kind of motivations that are called intrinsic motivations, which can help you to keep going even when it's difficult, and extrinsic motivations, which actually are going to let you down when the going gets tough. So the three intrinsic motivations that people talk about are purpose, autonomy, and mastery. And what that basically means is purpose is the sense of doing something that you really believe in. You know, if you're starting a business because you want to make a dent in the universe, as Steve Jobs said, and if you want to make other people's lives better, and you actually really want to see your product or your service realized in the world, that's something that can really keep you going, especially in the early days when it's difficult. Autonomy is all about the freedom aspect of entrepreneurship. You know, this is another thing that really motivates a lot of entrepreneurs, is the opportunity to choose for yourself what you should be working on and what your business should be about, and to decide for yourself how your resources should be best spent, and you know how what you should be doing with your business. And that's something that entrepreneurship obviously gives you a fantastic opportunity. And mastery is really about the opportunity to take on the challenges that your work gives you and get better at them. You know, if you can get enjoyment out of realizing, wow, I've started a business, I don't know anything about selling, I've really got to get a handle on this. And you know, if you can take that on as a challenge and actually get enjoyment from getting better and better at what you do, then that will really, really help you through. So I think if you can find those intrinsic motivations, the experience is so much more fulfilling and rewarding, and it also really helps you get through. And that, I think, is very different to sort of extrinsic motivations for entrepreneurship. If you're interested in starting a business because you want to impress people, or you know, want to have a sense of power or something, those kind of motivations are not going to get you through the hard initial period, especially because a lot of the time, you know, when it comes to sort of, for example, I mentioned selling, the skill of selling, a lot of the time you are going to experience indifference. Everyone's very busy. Everyone has got their own lives to lead. They're not necessarily interested in your new product or service, even if you think it's the most amazing thing. And you know, if you're really motivated by what people are thinking of you or how they're responding to you, then you're going to find it very hard to push through and keep going and learning from all of the kind of rejection or indifference that you might experience in the beginning.
Jake DeSillis, free man, host of the Voluntary Life podcast, voluntarylife.com. Jake, what I'd like to know, because we talk all the time about offshore businesses and the need to do that, yet when I ask, hey, why are people still opening businesses in California to the point that it's an entrepreneurial hotbed, even guys from the Ayn Rand Foundation can't really give me a straight answer. This is a place where they chase people down. I mean, you leave California owing 2 cents, and they will blow up your phone for 10 years. Even after you pay them the 2 cents, they're so inept they don't realize it, and then they keep chasing you down and making you miserable. Right. Help me out with this. Why wouldn't more entrepreneurs go to places like Mexico, like the Philippines, like Chile? Listen, people in the United States are trying to import talent from other countries. There are fixed startup costs. You got to live, you got to pay people, you got fixed costs anywhere you go. Why not have the lower costs in a place that is much, much cheaper? Walk me through this.
Yeah, I think if you do have a web-based business, that's a great opportunity because, as we were talking about with Mexico, you can live really well on much less. And in particular, in that first period, when you want to get a business going and you want to keep your costs as low as possible, that's a great opportunity if it is a web-based business. Of course, a lot of businesses won't be web-based. And my previous business was actually a consultancy. And so that was an onshore business. It was in London. That's where the market was for the kind of work that I was doing. So there are opportunities that are going to be harder to achieve in the initial period. And in some senses, you know, if there is a marketplace and there's an opportunity for you to start your entrepreneurial career, your experience, and get used to delivering value, like get experience in really getting value delivered, then you can still get that useful experience onshore, and you can look later in your entrepreneurial career to maybe move offshore and try other things. But if you are working online, then you have a fantastic opportunity to benefit from lower costs from going abroad, and of course to just get the experience of the world, to go out and internationalize yourself and see what it feels like to learn other languages, learn about other places and other culture.
Absolutely. I would even argue, though, because, you know, there's two mentalities. There is the winner mentality, the successful mentality, and then there's the loser mentality. And the winner mentality is the guy who's going to hole himself up in the room, and he's gonna bang it out for 6 months, and he doesn't need to live in San Francisco because he doesn't want to go to the hottest clubs or the parties or be part of the scene like you talked about. But the other aspect of that is I think that people increasingly, because I've seen this myself, even as a consultant with Vonage phones and VoIP and all these different things, I think people are becoming much more accepting of the fact that I don't really care where you are. Would you agree?
I think that can be the case. Again, it does depend on sort of what kind of services you're providing. So in the consultancy work that I was doing, I actually had my initial concept was going to be providing an application service over the internet. It was a particular type of computer modeling and simulation, and I wanted it to be, you know, completely geographically independent for all the benefits that brings. I actually found that it was a lot easier to make a successful business by providing that service face to face, because that's what the clients really wanted. And you know, you then face a choice. You think, okay, well, either you can take advantage of this opportunity and build this business and build it up, as I did, to a point where I eventually sold the business, and you can take advantage of all the opportunities that provides, or you can go in another direction. And if you realize that, okay, this business is just not going to work as a location independent business, then you can try something else. And there's obviously costs and benefits in both approaches, but there are still opportunities that you can take, you know, in your entrepreneurial career, as I said, that are onshore, and then you can look later to what you want to do overseas.
What are some of your suggestions for living abroad? Everyone has their own unique take on how to cope with that. Give us yours.
Well, I think what we've really learned over the last 7 months is just how much you benefit from kind of lightening your load, if you like, and not taking a lot of stuff with you. That goes for baggage, and people often talk about packing, packing light. I think even more importantly, especially if you want to work abroad, is just the huge advantages to going paperless and to having as much of your data in the cloud as possible. Obviously, you need to think about encryption and you know, some of the other aspects of using the cloud. But what we've found is that committing to going paperless and committing to having our data available in the cloud just gives you so much more flexibility, because it means that, you know, you if the worst happens and your laptop gets stolen, then okay, you've lost the laptop, but you haven't lost your data, and you know, you have that opportunity to move around and just know that your data is secure, hopefully encrypted in the cloud. The other thing that I've found is that in terms of traveling, I guess there are two approaches. Some people like to travel and stop in, you know, one place for a week and move on and so forth, and they stay in hotels or hostels. We've found it much, much better to just rent apartments longer term for a month or 2 months, because you get internet access, you get all of the, you know, mod cons that you want and everything, and you get a lot more of a stable base, particularly if you're working. So that's, you know, what we've probably most learned over this winter is just how the benefits of spending much longer in one or two places. And that's the way that we will travel in future as well.
I'm talking to Jake DeSellis from thevoluntarylife.com. It is a podcast. We'll come back with Jake and talk about all of the places in Latin America where the opportunities lie for expats. I'm Andrew Henderson. This is the Nomad Capitalist Report. Andrew Henderson, NomadCapitalist.com. We're back on the Nomad Capitalist Report with Jake DeSillis from the Voluntary Life Podcast. He's a global entrepreneur traveling the world, finding freedom in an unfree world. And what I think is the most important thing that we are seeing, we've talked about this at NomadCapitalist.com. We've talked about it on this radio show. The government does not want you to escape with your rights. If you do so, you're taking the first bold step towards empowering yourself, taking back that freedom. And not to mention, once you get into that box of freedom, you start to think, how do I increase my freedom so I have more time to spend with my family? How do I escape the 9-to-5? How do I quit the rat race? These are the things that we're talking about, and it's an important step to think about. Don't just dismiss, but to think about it. Jake DeSillis, the Voluntary Podcast, has traveled all over Latin America, especially. And I think, Jake, we've now ascertained if you set foot in Mexico, probably not likely to be dragged through the street, but let's head further south. South America, I talked to Adam Kokesh last week about places there that you can live. Paraguay has been a haven for people from Germany, et cetera, for years, for retirement. But let's talk about business. All the way at the southern end of South America, you've got two countries, I believe, that while some people say Argentina is the haven for expats, that it's really a capital-controlling, government-intrusive country run by a psychopath. And then you cross the Andes over to Chile, and you have a lot more freedom. Let's talk about Argentina, some of your thoughts on that country. Am I right or am I wrong?
Sadly, yeah, I would agree with you. I mean, we went to Buenos Aires and spent a month living there. And I mean, it's a strange experience because it's a beautiful town. And especially if you like big cities, and I do, I'm a fan of urban living. And Buenos Aires has beautiful streets and cafes and bars. And it's a very urbane place, especially within the context of South America. And yet, you know, you just see the sort of signs of collapse all around you. The electricity goes off all the time because of the subsidy of electricity companies, everyone using their aircon all the time. There are demonstrations and so forth. And we were there at the end of last year. Things have got worse since then. But the main thing that you see is the huge spread between the official exchange rate and the market exchange rate. And when we were there, it was about 30% difference, and I believe it's significantly more now.
It's double.
Yeah. So, you know, it's really a significant thing. And unfortunately, it's one of these instances where ridiculous laws like capital controls have all sorts of unintended consequences too. So, for example, what's happening now is that people in Buenos Aires are having to go to Uruguay to change money at the sort of market rate. And Uruguay, which all of the textbooks, all of the travel books tell you is a very quiet, sleepy place, now, unfortunately, Uruguay has got its reputation as being somewhere where there's a lot of people going to ATMs, changing money and walking around with a lot of cash. And there is a lot of crime now that's sprung up directly because of this situation with currency controls in Argentina. And the only time that we had any problems in Latin America was in Uruguay, where my fiance's bag got snatched. And that's, you know, so that's the only place that we actually ever encountered any crime.
So it's a good thing that the government is looking out for the citizens and making sure that everything they do is for the well-being of the people. And well, as long as they stay in the plantation, I guess, that's their problem. How dare they?
Right, right.
Traitors all. Across the Andes, though, Chile, you can register your company for free now. They have so many great systems they've put in place there. Talk about your experience in Chile.
Yeah, I mean, that's sort of night and day. And I think Chile's becoming better and better known for this. And I did an interview with an entrepreneur out there and met a few other people who've specifically gone to Chile to set up businesses and to be sort of expat entrepreneurs. You really get the sense that in Chile that this is an economy that is really booming and that the entrepreneurial culture there is far more ingrained. And so, yeah, it's a great opportunity and a really good location, I think, in many ways. It depends what you want. Santiago as a city is really nice, perhaps not as interesting in some ways as Buenos Aires, but in terms of the political economy at the moment, it's a far, far better place to look to set up a business.
So many, but certain people say that they want to move to Argentina because they think the Argentine government leaves them alone. I would argue the psychopath running it certainly wants to leave no one alone. But they would say, okay, well, the Chilean people, they're not as exciting as the Argentines who have kind of this revolution coursing through their veins. I want to make sure my money doesn't get cold, though. I mean, I think Chile, as you're saying, there's so many beautiful places there, no?
Yeah, absolutely. And I think, I mean, this is the thing in Argentina, you're going to have to deal with capital controls. And the issue there is that means that you either have to go get a ferry over to Uruguay to change money, or maybe you have to use Bitcoin. But even then, you have to find people who are willing to exchange with you and so forth. Chile is just a totally different environment. There is bureaucracy. I mean, it's not like it's a kind of, you know, completely free marketplace. There's still a lot of bureaucracy to do things there, but the basic sort of legal infrastructure and general sort of culture is far more accepting of and even encouraging of entrepreneurship. And so that, I think, is just a much better place. Certainly, if I was intending to, and as I said, I'm writing, and so we travel around. But if I was intending to set up a bricks and mortar business, and I wanted an actual location, then I would definitely prefer Chile over Argentina any day.
Well, Noah, what other country has said, listen, we're going to give out $40,000 grants to the best entrepreneurs and just kind of let it go viral? Hey, Jake DeSillis, thevoluntarylife.com, 1 minute left. Tell me, for Americans, North Americans, who are looking to maybe make a change, but they're afraid, they look at some of the places that guys like myself talk about, like, you know, in Asia, what have you. And they say, listen, that's probably too different for me. Speak to that from the perspective of Latin and South America, from your opinion.
Well, my view is that it's never been easier to go and check out these places for yourself. You know, if you look at things like Airbnb, you can so easily find yourself a beautiful apartment that's been peer-reviewed by a whole bunch of international travelers. And if you're concerned about finding out about what it might be like to live in these places, there's nothing better than going out there, even if it's just for a short amount of time, and experiencing it for yourself. You know, and you're definitely going to get a really good sense of whether or not this is for you or not. And you may be very pleasantly surprised.
Jake DeSillis, my guest, thevoluntarylife.com. Check out his podcast and everything else there. And he will show you just how so many of these preconceived notions can be so wrong. You've got to experience it for yourself. You've got to look outside the conventional thinking. Hey, Jake, thanks for being on the show.
Thanks so much for having me.